reflecting on the fact that this really is the highlight of the year in terms of the biblical calendar and the feasts of Israel, that the Day of Atonement is God's greatest work among us, the forgiveness of our sins and bringing us back into a relationship with Him. And I thought about, now it doesn't say this in the Bible, it does say it about Passover. Remember He said, with fervent desire, I've desired to keep the Passover. And I was reflecting, I wonder, and I think He does have the fervent desire to celebrate Yom Kippur with us as well, because they speak of the same thing. So God, we want to thank You for Your holy presence in our midst. Thank You for the momentous work that You have accomplished through atonement in Messiah Yeshua. One atonement once for all. Eternal atonement, eternal salvation, accomplished in one act of love. What a wonderful celebration, Lord. And we ask You to bring Your presence here tonight, to bring revelation here tonight, to bring revealing the nature and character of the atonement. And we thank You for this in Yeshua's name. And in Psalm 51, King David writes, Have mercy upon me, O God, according to Your loving kindness, according to Your to the multitude of Your tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me of my sin. King David was aware of his sin, and You and I are aware of our sin. And so we ask the Lord to bring cleansing here tonight in Yeshua's name. So I'm going to ask everyone to stand up. We're going to sing the Messianic version of the Shema, followed by Vinei Amar. If we could have that up here. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Baruch Shem, Kevod Mahalchuto, Leolam Vahed. Yeshua, Hu HaMashiach, Hu Adon HaKol. And now in English, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Praise be His name, whose glorious kingdom is forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And the next part, Yeshua is the Messiah. He is Lord of all. Amen. Amen. Ve'ne'emar ve'haya Adonai le'melech al kol ha'aretz b'yom ha'hu, b'yom ha'hu yiyeh Adonai echad. Ushma echad. From the book of Zechariah, in English, please. And it is said, Adonai shall be king over all the earth. On that day, the Lord will be one, and His name one. Amen. I'm going to ask the Roken family to come on up. Eugene is going to lead us in some readings, and the girls are going to light the candles.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kidshanu bidvaro venatan lanu et Yeshua Mashiachenu, uvishmo anachnu madlikim haneirot shel yom tov. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has sanctified us by his word, giving us Yeshua, our Messiah, and in whose name we light the festival lights. And Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Shechechiyanu VeKiyemanu VeHigiyanu LaZman Hazeh. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has granted us life, sustained us, and brought us to this season.
All right. It shall be for you a day of holy convocation, and you shall humble yourself and bring a fire offering to Adonai. And no manner of work shall you do on this same day, for it is a day of atonements, to make atonement for you before the Lord your God. And if they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers in their sin, which they sinned against me, and that they have walked contrary to me, and that I also have walked contrary to them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if their uncircumcised heart is humbled, and they accept their guilt, then I will remember my covenant with Jacob, and my covenant with Isaac, and my covenant with Abraham, I will remember, and I will remember the land.
Hallelujah. Let's sing this beautiful liturgical song. Matovu Uhalecha Yaakov. How beautiful are your tents, O Jacob.
Matovu Uhalecha Yaakov. Mishkenotecha Israel.
Slain.
Through your blood you have set us free, broken chains given victory. By your promise we enter in, lifting voices our praise begin.
Through your Hallelujah. And in case you are visiting us for the first time and wondering why we are dancing on Yom Kippur, it's because we are thankful for the atonement of the Lamb. Amen. Our next song is going to be a special song. You all know it. It's Jerusalem. And Yana will introduce it in Russian. And Adele will translate for you.
Песня называется «Иерусалим». Так как Иерусалим – это сердце Бога.
This song is called Jerusalem because Jerusalem is God's heart.
И в этот город возвратится наш очень ожидаемый Машиах Иешуа.
And into this city our Messiah will return.
И для этого мы очень ценим это место на земле.
And for this reason we cherish this city very greatly on this earth.
Но все мы с вами окажемся в небесном Иерусалиме.
But all of us will one day meet each other again in the heavenly Jerusalem.
Amen. Amen.
Day of the Lord.
Jerusalem, if you have shalom, endure with you alone. Our presence are like a lamb, salvation brought to man through wounds in Orient.
And you'll sing it in Russian. Song is straight from Isaiah chapter 53, the beautiful chapter in the Tanakh that clearly describes the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Who has believed the words that we have spoken? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For us He was pierced, for us His body broken, and a river of healing flows from Him.
Let's sing that again. Who has believed?
Who has believed the words that we have spoken? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For us He was pierced, for us His body broken, and a river of healing flows from Him.
Hear, O Israel.
Hear, O Israel. The Lord Hashem is one. Listen, all you scattered people. Hear, turn to the sound.
Who in His day?
His purpose, and who has considered what God has ordained? For us Messiah dies, for us He brings atonement, the Lamb of God on Pesach is slain.
Thank you, Lord. Hear, O Israel.
Hear, O Israel. The Lord Hashem is one. Atonement, the Lamb of God on Pesach is slain.
Hear, O Israel.
Hear, O Israel. The Lord Hashem is one. Listen, all scattered people. Hear, turn to the sun.
Oh. for forgiveness through Messiah. Amen.
Just remain standing. We're going to sing the blessing of Messiah, and then Tim is going to come and lead us in a reading, a beautiful reading, a messianic reading that we like to do on the high holidays. So let's do the blessing of Messiah. If we could have that up there, please. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Asher natan lano et derech ha-Yeshua B'mashiach Yeshua. Amen. In English, blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given us the way of salvation in Messiah Yeshua. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Please would you join me in this special reading? Thank you. He walked among us. He walked among us, filled with your Spirit, the only one who ever fulfilled your Torah. He healed the sick and raised the dead. The multitudes of our people sought his touch. He taught as no man taught. With authority, he brought forth the treasures of the Torah. How the children sought him. The lepers he touched and made clean. How the despised and outcast found love and release from their sin. Despised and rejected, acquainted with grief, he bore the sins of Israel. All we, like sheep, have gone astray, turned every one to his own way. Our iniquities were laid upon the King, the sins of the world his burden to bear. He rose from the dead and opened the way to life everlasting. Praise his name. We are in him. His Spirit empowers. New life is ours with joy and peace. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, who has given us Messiah Yeshua, our King. Amen.
Amen. You may remain standing as we sing this beautiful song that's based on, actually straight from Psalm 130, verse 1 to 4. And it says, out of the depths I call to you, Adonai. Adonai, please hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, Adonai, would record sins, who would be able to stand? For with you there is forgiveness, so that you may be feared. Hallelujah.
Adonai, Adonai. נשימה וקולי תהיה אוזניך קשובות לקוט החלומי עם עוונות תשמור יד
Let's give God praise for that. Wow. Amen. Please have a seat for a moment. Only a moment. That was beautiful. Wow. Well, Yom Kippur is, as we know, the Day of Atonement. And in order to receive forgiveness from God, we need to confess our sins before the Lord. We can't gloss over them, but we have to take responsibility for them, confess it, repent of it, and then receive the forgiveness and the grace to continue to walk empowered in the Lord. And on Yom Kippur, there is a tradition called Al Chet. Al Chet is a confession of sins before the Lord. And in fact, during Yom Kippur in temple days, and I'll be speaking about this in a little bit, the high priest chose two goats One was to be killed and the blood brought into the most holy place and sprinkled. Upon the head of the other goat, the high priest laid his hands and confessed over that goat the sins of Israel. So it was like al chet, right in the temple, over that goat. One was killed, and that was the means of atonement. The other goat confessed the sins of Israel and brought out of the camp to a desert place, carrying away the sins of Israel as far as east is from west. And if we are willing to humble ourselves tonight, to take responsibility for, you know, what's within our power, no matter what it is, maybe a situation at work, maybe at home, maybe here in the congregation, some situation where maybe you're taking on the role of a victim instead of taking personal responsibility. And so, Lord, I just pray as we confess these sins, Lord, that each of us would have courage, would have humility, and if we need to get right with a situation or someone, if we need to ask forgiveness or seek forgiveness, Lord, we just look to you right now that we would not just gloss over this, but it would come from our hearts, this time of confession in Yeshua's name. So we have three readers. I'm going to call up Cam, Yaakov, and Ari. Come right on up. And they're going to lead us in confession. Some of these sins may not apply to you. Some of them might. And the ones that do, you take it to heart. So we're going to, why don't we stand up then, and they're going to lead us in reading the Messianic Al Het.
If you would please join me in reading the following prayer. It's a Messianic addition to the traditional Yom Kippur prayer. Sins of omission, things we didn't do that we should have. For the sin we have committed against you by not loving you as we should, and for the sin we have committed against you by ingratitude, for the sin we have committed against you by not trusting you, and for the sin we have committed against you by unbelief, for the sin we have committed against you by neglecting the word of God, and for the sin we have committed against you by lack of prayer, for the sin we have committed against you by robbing you, and for the sin we have committed against you by not serving you with our time, tithes, and talents, for the sin we have committed against you by not caring for those in need, and for the sin we have committed against you by not reaching out with the good news to those who don't know you, for the sin we have committed against you by not honoring our parents, and for the sin we have committed against you by not honoring those in authority, for the sin we have committed against you by neglecting Shabbat services, and for the sin we have committed against you by neglecting corporate prayer. For all these sins, O God of forgiveness, forgive us and pardon us in Yeshua's name. Ve'al kulam Elohai Sechot Slak Lanu Mechal Lanu B'Shem Yeshua. Amen.
Let's read the second part, sins of commission, things we did that we should not have. For the sin we have committed against you by lying and by being deceitful, and for the sin we have committed against you by hypocrisy, for the sin we have committed against you by cheating and defrauding, and for the sin we have committed against you by greed and selfish ambition, for the sin we have committed against you by speaking gossip and slander, and for the sin we have committed against you by arrogance and pride, for the sin we have committed against you by vanity, and for the sin we have committed against you by levity, for the sin we have committed against you by rejecting personal responsibility, and for the sin we have committed against you by blaming others. For all these sins, O God of forgiveness, forgive us and pardon us in Yeshua's name. Ba'al kulam Elohai slichot, slach lanu, mechal lanu, b'shem Yeshua.
And the sins of commission. For the sin we have committed against you by worshiping other gods, and for the sin we have committed against you by idolatry, for the sin we have committed against you by self-indulgence, and for the sin we have committed against you by sexual immorality, for the sin we have committed against you by consulting the occult, and for the sin we have committed against you by drugs and addictions, for the sin we have committed against you by strife and contention, and for the sin we have committed against you by anger and rage, for the sin we have committed against you by yielding to evil, and for the sin we have committed against you by being stiff-necked. For all these sins, O God of forgiveness, forgive us and pardon us in Yeshua's name. Ve'al kulam Elohai slichot, slach lanu, michal lanu, b'shem Yeshua. Amen.
Yeah. And as we've just talked about sins and the forgiveness of the sin, this is a traditional song from the Siddur, Adon HaSlichot, O Lord of Forgiveness, the one who searches the inmost being of our hearts and knows what's going on in there, forgive us, O Lord. Selichot pochen levavot kolei amukot tover tzedakot
hadu beniflaot vati benechamot zo Chatzanu lefanecha.
rachem aleinu.
Hallelujah.
Well, Erev Yom Kippur is traditionally called Kol Nidre because of a special set of prayers that is said on that evening. And I want to give a little background. Kol Nidre means all vows. And basically, it is a renunciation of all vows that were forced upon the Jewish people in the Middle Ages. And I want to read a little portion from a Messianic rabbi who wrote about this. He gave a little background, and I don't usually do this, but I want to do it tonight, and I want you to understand the background of Kol Nidre. Why would the Jewish people renounce vows year to year? Why? Because they were forced to make vows under the threat of death. And so this rabbi writes, a religious fervor arose about the year 1000 with the inauguration of the Crusades, and a great wave of aggressiveness came into the body of Messiah. And while God always had a faithful remnant, the frenzied mobs that went to conquer the holy places from Islam in the name of Messiah had no concept of the kingdom of God. In other words, the Crusaders were not true believers in Messiah. They were in name only. They took the name, they co-opted the name of Messiah and committed atrocities in his name. Well, he never agreed with that. Furthermore, in the beginning of the 1200s, Pope Innocent III officially recognized the doctrine of transubstantiation. And that's when they say that the wafer turns into the actual body of Messiah. This is the Catholic Church. And the charge of host desecration was made against the Jews. That is, the Jews were accused of torture and destruction of the communion wafer, which was believed to be the literal body of Messiah, because Jews supposedly wanted to kill him again. In other words, all these accusations came against the Jewish people. And this became a cause for attacks on Jewish villages. Therefore, conversion of Jews was seen as urgently needed, and such methods as public debates over whether Messiah had already come, conversionist sermons by Catholic preachers in the synagogues with mandatory attendance by all Jews above age 12. And by 1411, a Dominican friar, Vincent Ferrar, led a mob through Castile on Shabbat, seizing a Torah scroll with one hand and a crucifix in the other, with a choice, baptism or death. And so that's the pressure, the community pressure that the Jewish people were under. And many Jews made vows to become, quote unquote, Catholic under duress. And thus the need arose for this Kol Nidre, this renunciation of vows. And so that's a brief historical background. We're not talking about renouncing, business contracts or agreements between men. We're talking about the renunciation of these forced conversion, turn or burn. Basically, that was the terminology. And so, so Avner Bosky, who's a Messianic Jew in Israel, developed Kol Nidre, a Messianic version of Kol Nidre. And so I'd like us to share this. We're doing a lot of readings tonight, but it's a special service. So I'm going to ask everyone to stand, please. And we're going to read this together. we're not renouncing our vows. We're renouncing any agreements we have with the kingdom of darkness. Amen? So again, this is by Avner Bosky, a Messianic Jew from Montreal who now lives in Israel. All vows which we have made to the forces of darkness, all agreements, all offerings of ourselves, all unclean desires and secret promises that we have vowed in our hearts, that we have promised in the hiddenness of our souls to the evil one from last Yom Kippur to this Yom Kippur, for all these, O God, we repent and we offer all of them up to you, O God, on the altar of your holiness. And we beseech you, based on the grace and based on the atoning blood of Yeshua, our Messiah, to make them of no effect and shatter them and pull them down and destroy them, and that you would crush all the wicked schemes of Satan in our lives, in the lives of our families, and in the lives of all the house of Israel. And let everyone say, amen. Amen. Let's give a shout. Hallelujah, Lord. We renounce the kingdom of darkness. We are not of the kingdom of darkness. We've been delivered out of the kingdom of darkness in Yeshua's name. And we renounce every aspect of the kingdom of darkness in our lives and in our congregation in Yeshua's name. Amen. Please have a seat. Just an announcement to make. Tomorrow, the service continues at 11 a.m., followed by four prayer slots. There are flyers on the back with all four prayer slots listed with what we're going to be praying for. I want to encourage you to be as much a part of all of these prayer slots as you can. We have four different leaders. And then a closing Ne'ilah service at 6 o'clock. Dima will be giving a closing message at that service. And after that, we're asking people to bring a prepared dish. Please bring a prepared dish to share with others. So that's how we're going to do it. You can't just show up for the break the fast. You have to show up to something, at least one of these slots, or at least the Ne'ilah service, but not just for the... Is that fair enough? All right. Okay, Eric is going to come and lead us in the next portion. Let's welcome Eric.
Great. Thank you, Rabbi Jeff. Shabbat shalom, everyone, and Shana Tova. I was given the opportunity to take on a special offering today. So this is above and beyond our tithes. And you can also use plastic as well and send e-transfers. So as we gather on this sacred day of Yom Kippur, we enter into a profound time of reflection, repentance, and renewal. This is a moment to draw closer to God and His mercy and grace. In Leviticus 16:30, we read, "For on this day shall atonement be made for you to cleanse you, and from all your sins you shall be clean before the Lord." Yom Kippur is a day of deep spiritual cleansing, and part of that renewal involves our hearts and willingness to give. As we consider our special offering today, let's remember the call in 2 Corinthians 9, 6 to 8, which basically teaches us about the spirit of generosity. Whomever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart. Not reluctantly, not under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. On this day of Yom Kippur, let us give from our hearts, transformed by His love and mercy. Our offerings today are not just about financial support. They are an act of worship and gratitude. So let's pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for the ultimate sacrifice that you have made for us, Lord God. Bless our offerings as well, Lord God, for your glory and honor in Yeshua's name. Ushers, please. Thank you.
Amen. And as we take up the offering, let's stand, sing this beautiful song that really shows us the value of forgiveness, because we cannot enter into heaven if our souls are impure with sin. And the only way that we have forgiveness of sin is through the Messiah. And that's what this beautiful song is about. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Darkness won't rest. There are no tears of pain. There's no everyday haste. No more striving, no strain.
Let's sing it one more time. I can show.
I can show.
to the city above through a heart that is filled with God's love. Only souls that are cleansed enter into those courts, into heaven. There's no other road.
Amen.
Another beautiful song. Wow. Watch that guitar. It tends to do that from time to time. Has a mind of its own, that thing.
Didn't play along.
Wow. What beautiful songs and music tonight. Wonderful. Let's thank God one more time. So sweet and lovely. Well, Erev Yom Kippur, I always begin by going back to Leviticus 23 as a foundation, because that is where all the feasts are listed in Leviticus 23. So I want us just to turn there, or you can look up here to Leviticus 23 and read a very small portion about Yom Kippur. Of course, 10 days ago, we heard the sound of the shofar. That was Yom Teruah, the day of the sounding, to get our attention and prepare us for this crucial day, Yom Kippur. And in Leviticus 23, verse 26, it says, "And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, also the 10th day of this 7th month shall be Yom HaKippurim, the Day of Atonements." Really, it's a plural word, Kippurim. "It shall be a holy convocation for you. You shall afflict your souls." Very serious. "You shall afflict your souls," which is commonly understood to be fasting. That's why we fast on Yom Kippur in fulfillment of this. "You shall afflict your souls." You know, I'm reading a book right now about the blessing of discomfort. One of the chapters is about food. And that it's okay to be hungry sometimes. It's actually good for us. "You shall afflict your souls and offer an offering made by fire to the Lord." Eric spoke about an additional offering that is made. "And you shall do no work on that same day, for it is the Day of Atonement, to make atonement for you before the Lord your God. For any person," listen to how serious God is here, "any person," you can write your name in there, "who is not afflicted of soul on that same day, he shall be cut off from his people." Now, of course, if you're pregnant and you need to eat, so you eat, you know, less, or if you're on medication that requires you to eat something, obviously there's flexibility there. But to do it in spirit as well. It says, "He shall be cut off from his people. And any person who does any work on that same day, that person I will destroy from among his people. You shall do no manner of work. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations in all your dwellings." I remember I was only in Israel once during Yom Kippur, and I was absolutely amazed. The whole nation shuts down. There's no cars, there's no nothing. And I said to myself, what other nation in the world does this? There's no other nation. The Torah was given to the nation of Israel. And in many ways, you know, we seek to do this today, but it's incredible. Verse 32, it shall be to you a Sabbath of solemn rest, and you shall afflict your souls on the ninth day of the month at evening. From evening to evening you shall celebrate your Shabbat. Now, so that's the introduction, and the details on how the atonement would be made on that day is explained in Leviticus 16. We're going to look at it in a minute, but in essence, I want to give a brief overview before we go there. On Yom Kippur, and this is a summary, you can look in Leviticus 16 and look at all these, only the anointed high priest could work that day. No one else could work. It was the day in which the high priest would work and labor and bring in the sacrifices for atonement. He would first kill a young bull and bring the blood of that bull into the most holy place with incense and sprinkle it on the east side of the mercy seat. And before the mercy seat, he would sprinkle the blood of that bull seven times. And that was to make atonement for himself and his family. A special blood sacrifice for the forgiveness of sins for the high priest and his family. Then he would select two goats, as I mentioned before, and cast lots for those goats. One to kill, and the other one would be the Azazel, or the scapegoat, that he laid his hands on and it was taken out of the camp. The goat to be killed is the sin offering for Kol Yisrael, all the people. And he would bring the blood inside the veil and sprinkle it the same way that he took the blood of the bull and he sprinkled that inside the veil. He would again then lay his hand on the other goat and confirm or confess all the sins of Israel over that Azazel. And the goat would be released and carried away. And so clearly these two goats equal one atonement. One is the means by which atonement would be made, killing the goat, sprinkling the blood inside the veil in the holy temple. And the other goat, over which the high priest confessed the sins, carried away those sins as far as east is from west. So it was the blood atonement that brought the removal of the sins. So we get a picture of the atonement in those two goats and in the bull for the high priest. But today, I want to focus on what happens to that bull and that goat that provided atonement. That's what I want to focus on today. And let's look again in Leviticus chapter 16. Leviticus chapter 16, verse 6. I'm going to now read a few of these verses. I gave a brief summary. Let's read it in the scriptures. Leviticus 16, verse 6, Aaron put on the high priestly garb. And in verse 6, it says, Aaron shall offer the bull as a sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house. And then verse 11, and Aaron shall bring the bull of the sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house, and shall kill the bull as a sin offering, which is for himself. Then he shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense, beaten fine, and bring it inside the veil. The blood of the bull and the incense was brought inside of the veil where the presence, the Shekhinah glory of God, dwelt in that inner place. And he shall put the incense of fire before the Lord, that the cloud of incense may cover the mercy seat that is on the testimony lest he die. You know, there was an Ark of the Covenant there. The Ark was there, and the cherubim and the dwelling presence of God. He shall take some of the blood of the bull and sprinkle it with his finger on the mercy seat on the east side, and before the mercy seat, he shall sprinkle some of the blood with his finger seven times. That's what the high priest did on Yom Kippur to make atonement for himself and his family. And then in verse 15, we see then he goes on to make atonement for the people of Israel. Then he shall kill the goat of the sin offering, which is for the people, bring its blood where? Inside the veil. And do with the blood as he did with the blood of the bull. Sprinkle it on the mercy seat and before the mercy seat. Now look in verse 27 and 28. What does he do with the blood and the body? Verse 27. The bull for the sin offering and the goat for the sin offering, whose blood was brought in, where was it brought in? Inside the veil, right? The bull for the sin offering and the goat for the sin offering, whose blood was brought in to make atonement in the holy place, shall be carried outside the camp. And they shall burn in the fire their skins, their flesh, and their offal. These verses here focus on the blood of the animals that was brought inside the veil, and it also speaks of the bodies of those animals that were brought outside the camp. The blood inside the veil, the body outside the camp. Now, as Messianic believers, we know that these animals point to Yeshua. Amen? These were temporary until the Messiah would come who would fulfill Yom Kippur. He's our final and eternal blood sacrifice. It points us to the blood of Yeshua, and it points to the body of Yeshua. And it also directs us as believers to our appointed places as well, inside the veil and outside the camp. The amazing book of Hebrews, the book of Hebrews is like what Leviticus is to the Torah, the book of Hebrews is to the New Covenant. It's very finely detailed. And the writer of the book of Hebrews gives us a rich midrash on these verses that we just read in this portion. So I want us to look now in the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 13, for a messianic midrash of these verses that speak of the blood being brought inside the veil and the body being brought outside the camp. Hebrews 13, verse 8. Yeshua HaMashiach is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Wow, what a verse. Do not be carried about with various and strange doctrines. For it is good that the heart be established by grace, not with foods which have not profited those who have been occupied with them. We have an altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. Now look in verse 11. He's referring specifically to the verses we just read. For the bodies of those beasts whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin are burned outside the camp. So he understands exactly what happened. Therefore, now he makes a messianic application. Therefore, Yeshua also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered outside the gate. Therefore, now there's an application. Therefore, let us go forth to him outside the camp, bearing his reproach. For here we have no continuing city. We sang of the city that does continue. But here we have no continuing city, but we seek the one to come, the city of gold, if you will. Therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God, that is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. So I want to speak about this messianic midrash on this Torah portion that we just read. Hebrews 13, verse 8, Yeshua the Messiah is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Messianic Judaism is Messiah-centered Judaism. If you take Messiah away from Messianic Judaism, we have nothing. We have nothing. He's the center and substance of our Judaism. Without Yeshua in the center, the scriptures of the Tanakh are incomplete. And they don't really make any sense unless Yeshua is in the center. I put it this way, that the Tanakh, which is the Old Testament, is the perfect word of God, but it's incomplete by design. How many of you have ever seen a movie that at the end of the movie, there's a clear indication that there's going to be a sequel? We've all seen movies. They leave you hanging. You know, you could just say, ah, when's part two coming out, right? A sequel. Well, the Tanakh, the Old Testament, speaks of a sequel to come. There's more coming all throughout the scriptures. There's a yad pointing forward, a hand pointing forward. For example, the last written book of the Old Testament, or the Tanakh, is the book of Malachi. Malachi. It's the last written book in the Tanakh. And I want us to read this indication that a sequel is coming. A finger is pointing forward in Malachi chapter 3, verse 1. God is saying, behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord, Adon, whom you seek, will suddenly come to his temple. Even Malach HaBrit, the messenger of the covenant, in whom you delight, behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. The last written book of the Old Testament says, there's more coming. He's coming. It's incomplete. 400 years later, Yochanan arose, John the Immerser. He was that messenger. And he was the one who called the people to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. There comes one after me, the sole of whose shoe I'm not worthy to even carry. And he was speaking of Yeshua, the Messiah. Adon, the Lord of all, came in the person of Yeshua. And because he is the Lord of whom Malachi spoke, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, because he is the Lord, because he is God, he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so that's why that's here in Hebrews chapter 13. Turning back there to Hebrews 13, verse 9, he says, do not be carried away with various and strange doctrines. For it is good that the heart be established by grace, not with foods which have not profited those who have been occupied with them. The point here is that since Yeshua is the center of our Messianic Judaism, don't get sidetracked with various other things and carried away. Varied and strange doctrines that emphasize external things that will not cause us to grow. What will cause us to grow is the grace that flows from Yeshua. For it is good that the heart be established by grace that flows from Yeshua. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Yeshua. That's John 1:17. It is good for the heart to be established and strengthened by grace. Now, grace is not an excuse for low-level spirituality or an excuse for staying the same. Well, God understands me. He knows my heart. Of course he knows your heart. That's why he gives us grace. Grace that gives us power to change. Not grace that makes an excuse that we stay in our sin. Amen? It's not sloppy grace. It is empowering grace. Grace leads us to frankly admit that we can't change or grow on our own. You can't do it on your own. Grace causes us to cry out to the Lord for help in prayer, not just accept status quo. We can't just accept status quo. Grace that asks for a promise in the Word of God and takes hold of it and believes. Grace causing us to act on the Word with power from the Holy Spirit. There is power to change, my friends. And it's found in the grace of God. That's the empowering grace that strengthens the heart. It is good for the heart to be established or strengthened by grace and causes us to grow. But look at the means by which grace flows to us in verse 10. Hebrews 13, verse 10. We have an altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. And what is that? That's the altar. Messiah's altar is the tree of sacrifice. It is the tree or the cross that empowering grace flows to us through the cross of Messiah. Those who serve the tabernacle are the priests and the Levites. He says in verse 10, we have an altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. The priests and the Levites, who are by the law of Moses given the right to eat from the altar, from those daily sacrifices, they have the right to eat. But Messiah's altar is not like the daily sacrifices. It's more like the Yom Kippur sacrifice that is totally separate. So even the Levites had no right to eat that Yom Kippur sacrifice. That's what he's talking about here. Verse 11, for the bodies of those beasts whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin are burned outside the camp. Notice here again, the blood brought inside, the body brought outside. Verse 12, therefore Yeshua also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered outside the gate. Therefore, just like the Yom Kippur sacrifice, there were two crucial elements to Yeshua's sacrifice. Yeshua's blood and Yeshua's body. They both brought atonement for Israel. They both brought atonement. These are the very things we remember when we, as followers of Yeshua, partake of the Passover of the New Covenant. The very two same elements. Ze gufi. This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me. Ze dami. This is my blood of the New Covenant. We partake of that body and we partake of that blood. But look where the blood and the body went. After his trial, Yeshua was led outside the gates of Jerusalem and endured the fiery trial on the altar of that cross. That cross was like Yom Kippur. Hebrews 13, verse 12 says, therefore Yeshua, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered outside the gate. After Yeshua rose from the dead, he brought his blood into the heavenly sanctuary, into the most holy place inside the veil as a Yom Kippur sacrifice for sins. And that's, let's look in Hebrews 9. Like I said, Hebrews is just like the book of Leviticus. Hebrews 9, verse 11. But Messiah came as high priest of the good things to come with the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands. That is not of this creation. Yeshua did not sprinkle his blood in the earth, in the earthly tabernacle. He went right up into the heavenly tabernacle, the heavenly temple. Not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood. He entered the most holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Messiah, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Surely our sins are forgiven through his body and his blood. His blood was sprinkled, his body was outside the gate, just like the Yom Kippur sacrifice. It's so amazing how the hand fits in the glove here. But there's more. Hebrews 13, turning back to Hebrews 13, verse 13. There's a call to us in all of this. Messiah has done his part. His blood sprinkled, his body outside the gate. Verse 13, therefore, this is a call to us. This is a word from the Lord for us on this Yom Kippur. Let us go forth to him outside the camp, bearing his reproach. For here, this earthly dwelling, we have no continuing city, but we seek the one to come. It is the location of the blood and the body which directs us as believers to our appointed place. I believe this blood and body speaks to us. Where is that blood right now? It's inside the veil. And that's exactly where we have been called to by the Lord. We've been called to come inside the veil where the blood was sprinkled to bring us near to God. Look in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19. This is an appeal from the Holy Spirit. Therefore, brothers, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Yeshua, it calls us in behind the veil by a new and a living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near. Come in behind the veil to where the presence is. Let us draw near with a true heart. In other words, what's the purpose of Yom Kippur? To draw near to God. That's the whole purpose. Draw near, come into his presence. In full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water, let us hold the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Our ministry to the Lord is inside the veil. That's why it says, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise. Where? Not outside somewhere, far, far away, but right inside the veil, worshiping him, ministering to him. It's the blood and the body that made the way for us to come in. We belong inside the veil to make intercession, to minister to the Lord, to make intercession, and really to change the course of history. Inside that veil, we can change the course of history. We can influence and change the world because inside that veil, we have power and authority with God. Our prayers matter. The prayers that we're praying tonight and throughout the day tomorrow, they really matter. It means something. They're prayed inside the veil, where there's a God with whom nothing is impossible. But secondly, not only are we appointed to come inside the veil, where the blood of Messiah is, but we are appointed to the place where the body of Messiah is as well. Hebrews 13, again, verse 13. Therefore, let us go forth to him outside the camp, bearing his reproach. What does that mean? To follow Messiah, we need to be willing to be different. Outside of traditional camps. First, separation from the world. We're called to make a separation from the sinful way of this world. Outside the camp. The camp is where everyone's, you know, the world, so to speak. We're outside of religious tradition as well. Frankly, outside of traditional rabbinic Judaism. Rabbinic Judaism teaches that God no longer requires blood to make atonement for sin. Well, you've got to go outside that camp in order to receive Yeshua. They believe that repentance, prayer, and tzedakah is enough to make atonement. But we just read what the Torah demands, the blood and the body of that offering, which of course is Yeshua. We need to go outside the camp of every other religious system, including Kabbalah, mystical Judaism, a pseudo-spiritual, mystical approach to God, which is not of God. And if you've been in Kabbalah, you need to renounce it. It's a false way of spirituality. Outside the camp of Eastern philosophies and the occult, involvement in the occult will bring you in touch with demons. And remember, we did the renunciation of all demonic forces. We've renounced them. outside the camp of acceptance by family and friends. Sometimes we will be rejected by our own family and friends. And the scripture says we have to be willing to go outside the camp. Amen. Amen. Many of us have endured that. I've shared with you my sister Paula. I hope she comes here sometime and gives her testimony. She was the first one in our Jewish family to receive Yeshua. And I was a 20-something, and I heard, oh, there's Paula in her room reading the Bible. We mocked her. We mocked her. We gave her a lot of tsuris. And then my mother became a believer. There goes Mom and her Godmobile. We mocked me and my brother and my dad. We mocked, and the first one to receive Messiah in a family basically has to catch the wind. But you know what? Our whole family got saved. Eventually, our whole family, even my dad, on his deathbed, I got there just in time with Ari, and I led him to the Lord on his deathbed. He had heard it all his life, and I believe that he received the Lord on his deathbed. So you never know. Outside the camp, bearing his reproach. And it's our calling to bring others with us, to call people who are in the camp to come outside the camp to where Messiah is. That is our calling. And so Yeshua's blood was brought inside the veil, into the Holy of Holies as an atonement. We too are called to be there inside the veil to minister to the Lord and to engage in intercession that changes the world. Yeshua's body was brought outside the camp. We too must go forth to him outside the camp, but our calling is to bring others with us outside the camp. Yom Kippur, inside the veil, outside the camp. And that is God's word for us tonight. Lord, I want to thank you for this amazing midrash from Hebrews chapter 13 on this portion of Leviticus 16 that we read about the blood being brought in to the most holy place and the body brought outside the camp. Lord, the writer of the book of Hebrews made an application to Yeshua and to us, that it's pointing to Yeshua, but it's a calling to us to come inside the veil and to be willing to go outside the camp. In Yeshua's name, amen. Why don't we stand and we'll sing this song together.
Behold the Lamb of God, the Lamb who takes away the sin of our world.
Behold the Lamb of God, who has borne the sin of the world. Have mercy upon us, Redeemer and Lord, Son of God, our Messiah.
Behold.
Behold the Redeemer and Lord, Son of God, our Messiah.
Lord, we invite your Holy Spirit here. Lord, we've heard about the blood and the body of Yeshua the Messiah. That brings the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's the gospel. And that brings the presence of the Spirit. I'm asking you now to release your anointing here. Release a breakthrough anointing of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Just begin to invite the Spirit upon your life, upon your mind, upon your heart. Holy Spirit, come, wash me. Bring your presence. Let's all invite the presence of the Spirit. Invite the presence. Holy Spirit, come. Responds to the blood and faith. Soften our hearts. Heal us, Lord. Whatever's hindering you from God's presence, deal with it. Bring it before Him. From the evil one. Deliver us from pride. Thank you, Holy One. Just continue to ask the Lord, come into my life. Spirit of God, come, immerse me now. Invite the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, come. About you, but I want to change. I want to continue to grow. And I know one thing, if I keep doing what I'm doing, I'm not going to grow very much. I have to be willing to do something different. So for some of us, when I say ask the Holy Spirit to come, maybe it feels uncomfortable to do that. But I'm inviting you to do something different. Speak to the Holy Spirit and ask Him to come into your life in a fresh, new way. Holy Spirit, come in a fresh, new way. If you want Him, if you want a new touch, if you don't, okay. But Lord, I want for myself. And I want for us to have a fresh, new touch of the Holy Spirit. Come, Lord, and do what only you can do. Hallelujah. Just going to wait another minute or two. Just anoint us for prayer, even tonight and throughout tomorrow. Anoint us to be world changers inside the veil. Thank you, Lord. And if you've never received Yeshua as your Messiah, you can reach out and ask Yeshua to come into your life. Yeshua, come into my life. I need to be forgiven. Cleanse me of my sin on this day of Yom Kippur.
Thank you. מלאך בטרם כל יציר נבנה את נשא ורבצו כל הזמל לשמוע נקרא ואחרי נשבות הכל לבדו עם לא גדולה והוא היה והוא עובר והוא נהיה בתפארה אדון עולם השם מלאך בטרם כל יציר נבנה את נשא ורבצו כל הזמל לשמוע נקרא אחרי ככלות הכל לבדו עם לא גדולה והוא היה והוא עובר בציפרה, והוא היה והוא עובד בציפרה והוא אחד ואין שני ועם שלום והבירה ומראשית ומתאפלית
beautiful flowers here, Yom Kippur flowers depicting really the theme in beauty here. Amen. Shabbat Shalom, everyone. Our Yom Kippur continues tomorrow at 11 throughout the day.